Ok. Bah, si ça vous va, on va commencer. Il y en a qui me connaissent déjà parce qu'ils sont sustainable challenges avec moi. Sustainable challenges. Et sinon, pour faire court, je suis dans le programme doctoral ici à l'Université de Liège. Je donne des cours en tant qu'assistant en énergie market, en sustainable energy. Il y en a qui m'ont aussi en microgrid, etc. Et là, aujourd'hui, je vais vous faire une petite intervention un peu plus spécifique dans le cadre du cours, du point de vue d'un fournisseur d'énergie. En fait, pourquoi? Parce qu'avant de faire doctorat, j'ai travaillé pour un fournisseur d'énergie, j'étais responsable d'énergie d'un fournisseur. Donc, je m'occupais de tout ce qui était trading d'énergie, les contrats, etc. Et en fait, c'est pour vous expliquer comment un fournisseur d'énergie, comme Empiris, Engie, etc., Luminous, vous construit pour vous, les clients résidentiels, donc vous et moi, construit des offres d'énergie. Parce que quand vous prenez un contrat d'électricité ou de gaz, vous avez des offres, soit prix fixe, soit prix variable. Et l'idée, c'est de vous expliquer un peu c'est quoi, comment on les construit, comment on fait les prix de ces offres, c'est quoi une offre verte. Parce qu'on parle d'offre verte aujourd'hui, c'est quoi en fait, etc. Et un peu aussi pour rappeler les différents acteurs sur le marché de l'énergie. Et là aussi, ce qui est assez, entre guillemets, cool, mais ce n'est pas cool pour les gens, c'est qu'il y a une augmentation du prix de l'énergie et du gaz, je pense que vous en avez entendu parler. Et donc moi, je vais profiter de cette opportunité-là aussi pour vous en parler, c'est assez inédit ce qui est en train de se passer. Et en fait, je vais faire un focus pendant une bonne demi-heure là-dessus aujourd'hui, je vais rajouter au dernier moment, mais je pense que c'est super important pour vous de comprendre ce qui se passe actuellement, parce que ça va peut-être, il va peut-être se passer des choses particulières dans les mois à venir sur le plan énergétique. Alors avant de commencer, ceux qui sont en cours avec moi, ils le savent déjà, mais ils ne vous disent rien. Est-ce que vous savez ce qu'on peut faire avec 1 kWh? Avec 1 kWh d'énergie, qu'est-ce qu'on peut faire?
Allumer une chaufferette dans les neufs.
Allumer une chaufferette?
Ouais.
Une chaufferette, c'est-à-dire, quand on dit une chaufferette, c'est un radiateur ou c'est
une chaufferette dans la salle de bain?
Ouais. Ok. T'es sûr?
Ouais.
Ok. D'accord, vas-y. Ouais, ok, donc là, ok, d'accord. Et sinon, ok, d'accord, très bien. Continuez encore. D'autres idées, qu'est-ce que je fais avec... est-ce que c'est beaucoup d'énergie un kilowattheure? Est-ce que pour vous, c'est beaucoup d'énergie? Quand même? Non? Oui, non? Ok, bon, on va voir. Est-ce que vous avez une idée de la consommation moyenne d'énergie que vous, en tant que particulier, vous avez à la maison? C'est-à-dire, prenez votre consommation d'électricité ou consommation de gaz, est-ce que vous avez une idée de combien vous avez de kilowattheures dessus à l'année?
3500 plus ou moins pour la maison.
On met en quoi, électricité ou gaz?
Électricité.
Donc 3500, j'entends, kilowattheures, ok. Il y en a qui diraient plus, moins. Bof, c'est pas trop. Qui dit plus? Ceux qui disent plus, lèvent la main. Ok. Qui dit moins? Ceux qui disent moins, lèvent la main. Personne en fait, tout le monde est endormi. Il y a eu un chapitre hier. Vous êtes tous d'accord sur 3500 kWh? On a tous 3500 kWh de conso. Ok, très bien. C'est... En Belgique, on est comme ça. Et en gaz, du coup? En gaz, vous diriez combien? Des idées? Ne soyez pas timide, je ne vais pas vous manger. Vas-y. 20 000 kWh, ok. Qui dit plus? Bonjour, viens. Qui dit plus? Personne. Qui dit moins? Un peu moins? Ok, d'accord. Ça marche.
Vous n'avez rien loupé. Hein.
Alors, du coup, c'est pas faux. En gros, en moyenne, la consommation électrique d'un ménage belge, en moyenne, c'est entre 3 000 et 5 000 kWh. Voilà, alors, il y en a qui sont peut-être à 2 000, hein, ceux qui ne consomment vraiment pas beaucoup. Mais c'est, en gros, c'est ça les ordres de grandeur. Et en gaz, on est entre 10 000 et 20 000 kWh. Mais ça peut être plus, ça peut être 30 000 kWh. Alors, à 4 kWh, qu'est-ce qu'on peut faire? On peut porter 100 kg du niveau de la mer jusqu'à 3 600 mètres d'altitude. Donc, alors, est-ce que c'est beaucoup ou pas beaucoup d'énergie? Moi, je ne sais pas, mais si je dois porter 100 kg dans mon sac à dos et faire 3 600 mètres de dénivelé, pour moi, c'est beaucoup. Alors, c'est vrai que ça vous paraît peut-être pas beaucoup parce que vous appuyez sur un bouton et ça marche tout seul.
Ouais.
Ah, c'est ok. So you do not speak French? You cannot speak French? Ok, so I have to speak in English. Ok, so I speak in English. So with 1 kilowatt of energy, you can carry 100 kilo from sea level to 3,600 meters. So for me, it's a lot. Maybe for you, it's not a lot, but for me, it's a lot. And with 1 kilowatt So you can do 30 km by foot, 2 km by car. You can expose 1 kilo of TNT. And with 1 liter of oil, you have 10 kilowatt. So for me, 1 kilowatt, it's a lot of energy. And if you take the human body, on average, you have 1 or 2 kilowatt per day in terms of mechanical energy. So 1 kilowatt of energy, in fact, it's a lot. But as we have a lot of energy around us, it seems not a lot because we consume, as you have seen, 20,000 kilowatt per year of gas. So imagine what we can do with 20,000 kilowatt. Have you already seen this video, Robert, this man? This German guy, some of you, some that are in the course with me have already seen it, but maybe I don't know the other one. No? Okay, so we'll have a look at this video. It is a toaster challenge. We will switch off the light, otherwise we don't. Why acoustic for 2 minutes? So you can see this guy, he's quite big. And he will try to toast one slice of bread.
Ready? Everything is okay with the handlebar, seat post, shoes, seat.
Okay. Everyone on positions now. We're getting ready for take. And remember that when Robert loses power, the toaster will pop up.
You can feel like it takes the blood in your mouth. Want to lie down?
My legs hurt.
Yeah, put them up. The monster is beaten.
Nobody can believe if you do it at the breakfast. Inside the toaster, nobody can believe how much work it is to toast it. Eh?
No, no.
I know it now. It's crazy. It's fucking hard.
Thank you. Okay. I want the picture with you, Robert.
Oh, okay. We're talking about the service more.
In a pants, it's more less. You look so very tiny.
My legs are tiny.
Yeah, I know.
Okay, so is 1 kilowatt a lot of energy or not? In your opinion. Imagine you want to do that every morning for your toast. Okay, so in fact, 1 kilowatt-hour of Unabit is a lot, even if we have access in daily life to 100 and 1,000 of kilowatt-hour just like that. And do you know why? Why is it so easy for us to have 100 and 1,000 of kilowatt-hour just like that?
Because of fossil fuels.
Fossil fuels. Okay, and what are the main fossil fuels? Petrol in English.
Oil.
So oil. Then
coal
and
gas.
And gas. Do you know what is the main energy in the world? What is the energy that is the most consumed in the world right now? And that has been the first one over the last decades. Oil is the first energy in the world. And then what it is?
Gas.
And then
coal.
85% of the energy consumed in the world is gas, coal, and oil. And the remaining 15% are 5% of nuclear energy. And then on the 10%, you have biomass and hydraulic, and you have maybe 1 or 2% of the industry. So as you see, the energy transition is still a long way, even if we talk about that all the time. So now, after that short video, I will provide you some key data about the Belgian primary energy consumption, about electricity, and also gas. And then I will focus on the increase of the gas price and the electricity price. So do you have any idea about the Belgian energy primary consumption in terms of amount of energy? Any idea? Is it 1 kilowatt-hour? 100 kilowatt-hour? Terawatt-hour? 100 of terawatt-hour? 1,000 of terawatt-hour? No idea? Are you in energy market? No, is it energy market here? No? I am not sure. So no idea at all. Hundreds of terawatt-hour, yes, okay. Hundreds of terawatt-hour, something like that, probably. Sorry? 400 of terawatt-hour, okay, probably something like that. And do you know about the share of fossil energy into that amount of energy? Do you have any idea about that? At the world scale, it is 85% of fossil energy. But as you know, in Belgium, we have the energy transition that started a long time ago. So imagine what is now the share of fossil energy.
30%?
70% for gas.
70? Of all the primary energy?
No, but for heating.
Yeah, but that's not the question. It's the primary energy of Belgium, not me. All the energy consumed in Belgium. So you told me 30% of all the energy consumed in Belgium is the fossil energy. Mm-hmm. 30%? Someone else? So it means that here in Belgium, if we have 30% of fossil energy, it means that 70% of the energy is something else, like renewable energy. 60% of fossil energy.
We consider the car as
everything. When I say primary energy consumption, it is all the energy, primary energy consumption.
At least
70%. 70% of fossil energy.
Yes.
Okay. It's more like 70%. In fact, in Belgium, it's almost as in every country in the world, fossil energy. And the share of renewable energies. What do you think is the main renewable energy in Belgium? Wind, solar, or hydro?
Wind.
And do you know about the share of nuclear energy? The primary energy consumption, not electricity, primary energy consumption. 5%? Okay, we'll see. And do you know the difference between the primary energy and the final energy consumption? What is the difference? It's very important to make the difference between them.
Some energy when they the primary energy, it's not same.
Yes, okay. So there's something like that. Is electricity a primary energy?
No.
So where does come from electricity? Okay. So nuclear is the primary energy. Renewable energy are primary energy. Fossil energy are primary energy. So the link between primary energy and energy consumption, that you can consume electricity. So you see that something happened between primary energy and electricity, for instance. Something happened. So as you said, there are some laws into the main grid, but it's not only that. How do you produce electricity?
Conversion
associates. So what happened in a nuclear power plant? In fact, you just use nuclear energy to boil oil, to boil water, to heat water, just that what we do. The same thing in a coal power plant or in a gas power plant. You heat something. And with that something, you can produce energy and electricity. So you have a lot of losses related to efficiency. So final energy consumption is what we consume, electricity, but it can be also oil when you use your car, or gas when you heat your house. But makes a difference. And do you know the share of electricity in the final energy consumption? So what we consume directly as consumers, all the energy of Belgium that we consume directly as consumers, do you know the share of electricity? Any idea? 5%, 10%, 30%, 50%, 90%? 20%? So let's see now. So here you have the primary energy consumption for Belgium. So here it is oil. Or so the unit is megatep. You can translate that into terawatt. Equivalent ton of oil, megatep. So you have oil, first oil. Then you have gas, a little bit of coal. Yes, we still have coal in Belgium, not for electricity, but for industry. Nuclear energy and renewable energy. So you can see the amount. So the first energy we use in Belgium, primary energy, it is oil and then gas, and then nuclear. And if we look at the final energy consumption, it is still oil, then you have gas, and then we have electricity. And you can see that here you have less energy than here, due to losses, transportation, transformation, and so on. Just energy that disappeared into the, we just lost that energy. And so if we look at the primary energy consumption, we have oil, gas, and coal. We have 71% of the primary energy consumption of Belgium that are fossil energies. Then we have renewable, about 9%. And electricity, it amounts for almost 20%. So it was good. 20% only. So in the media, a lot of time we only talk about electricity, 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 but it is only 20% of the final energy consumption, only 20%. The vast majority of energy that we use, it is not electricity, it is oil and gas. Oil for car, for truck and so on, for mobility, and gas just for heating or for industry. So you can, have more data on this thing. And here you have the primary energy consumption of Belgium through the last decade. So here it was 10 years ago, 1 year ago during the COVID crisis. And you can see that in fact, it is almost constant through the last decade. Here you have the share of oil. So sometimes it fluctuates a little bit. Here gas, here coal, here nuclear, and here you have renewable. So it is true that renewable, it increased a little bit for the last decade. But as you can see, it is not so much fluctuating. And here you have, so the last year, which was quite special, but of course, the COVID crisis. And so you can see that here, there has been a little decrease. So a small amount of energy has not been consumed last year, but it is only 5 or 10% of the energy. So imagine how much of the energy we use. In fact, it is not directly for us. During the COVID crisis, we did not stop of eating. We eat a lot, of course, it's normal, otherwise we die. We have to heat, we use electricity, the industry that are just running. So it's almost nothing happened, even if there has been a decrease of 10%. So when politics say we have gone through a drastic energy transition in Belgium, you can tell them, okay, but why we still use so much amount of oil, gas, and coal? because it's, they have a wonderful energy and it's very difficult to replace them.
Okay.
Do you know, do you have any idea about the shares of residential transport and industry into the final energy consumption? So if I take all the energy, final energy consumption in Belgium, and I try to determine the amount of energy for residential, so us, our needs, transport, mobility, or industry. Do you have any idea about that? Yes.
70% of industry.
So a lot of majority for industry, and the rest for mobility and
yes.
Something like that? Okay. And do you have any idea about the shares of heat? So if we focus on residential energy consumption now, so us, residential customer, you have any idea of the share of energy for heating and domestic hot water and electricity? Any idea? You told me one figure about that 5 minutes ago. About the share of heating in residential energy consumption.
Yes, something like 70% yes. For the house.
Yes.
So if you have a look at the final energy consumption per sector, in fact, industry is not 70%, even if it is a main consumer.
Then you have mobility, and you have also residential consumption. And if you look at the energy for residential consumption, heating is like 70%. So the vast majority of energy that we use here at home is just for heating. Nothing else, just heating. And then you use energy to heat water when you take a hot shower. And then you have electricity is like 15%. So as you can see, in fact, electricity, even if we use a lot of electricity, it is almost all the time a minor part into the energy consumption. Okay, now, do you have any idea about the shares of nuclear, gas, and renewable into the Belgian electricity production? So 30, 30, 30. Okay. Any other idea? 30%? 50% on nuclear? 20 from renewable? Something like that? Okay. And do you have any idea about the total amount of electricity production in Belgium last year in terms of terawatt? You can do the math. How many people do you have in Belgium?
12 million.
12 billion, yes. And they consume on average 3,000 kilowatt. You don't know, so how much is it? Can you do that? You have a computer or another one?
40 terawatt hour.
Something like that. So probably it is something in terms of terawatt, probably maybe 40, 50, something like that. So you can see that it's very easy to do a simple calculation and to get an idea. You are an engineer, I assume, so you can do that very quickly. So some probably something like 40, 50 terawatt, probably something like that. So let's have a look at it. So the total last year was 88, but you get, when you do just simple math calculation, you have the same amount. So nuclear was the first one in terms of production. Then you have gas and renewable. And it is almost the same for every year, as you can see here. So it is the Belgian electricity production over the last decade. So of course, during the COVID crisis, it was a little bit less, but as you can see, there has been over years before that were less electricity production. And you can see the share of nuclear, it fluctuates every year. Do you know why? Why is it not constant, nuclear? You have any idea? Because for instance, between this year and this one, you have a difference of 20 terawatt. Sorry?
There is maintenance.
Maintenance? Yes. Okay. And do you know what happened in Belgium for nuclear power plant in 2015?
Yes.
Yes?
Microcracks? Yes. 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 Exactly.
There has been a massive stop of nuclear power plant in Belgium due to these cracks in that year. So, and it was a very difficult year in terms of electricity, because the consumption was not decreasing. So that it explains this particular year. And for the other one, it depends. Sometimes it is maintenance and so on, or sometimes you know, something happens and you just have to shut down the nuclear reactor or something. And so you can see that the share of renewable has been increasing over the last decade in terms of terawatt. But still, gas and nuclear, they represent the vast majority of electricity production in Belgium. And during the COVID crisis, there has been a little bit small decrease, but not so much. Do you have any idea about the shares of wind, PV, hydro, and biomass in electricity production? So I heard earlier that maybe it was wind, the first renewable energy in Belgium. So probably maybe it will be wind, but do you have any idea about the share? If we just look at the renewable energy productions, the shares of this renewable energy. Sorry? 10% for wind? If you just look at the renewable energy. 15 for wind?
No, or how much for
the shares of, if we just look at the renewable energy production, what are the shares of this energy into that production?
Okay, totally it's not 15.
Total is 100% of, you have 100% of renewable energy.
Oh, okay.
And you, how much of wind, PV, hydro? Do not be afraid, I will not hit you. I already had breakfast. Should be okay for 1 hour today. So wind, maybe? Like 30%, 40%, 50%?
60.
60, okay. And the rest for the other one?
Not so easy, in fact, huh, to know. Huh?
So hydro, almost nothing. So yes, it is PV, the first one. So and almost 50%. So 50% of the renewable energy for electricity in Belgium, it is wind power. But with wind, in fact, we are only right now producing electricity. Maybe in 10 or 15, 20 years, we do something else like hydrogen. Yes. I don't know for this data. I assume it is because it's quite rare to have a very big PV farm plant. So I think so, but I am not 100% sure. But so first we have wind power, then we have PV, a little bit of biomass, and hydro, it's nothing, but you already know.
And here it is the evolution during the last decade.
And as you can see, almost everything has increased, in particular solar and wind. But you can see that the wind, in terms of terawatt hour, it really has increased over the last decade. Solar also, but you can see we have 10 terawatt hour. Maybe a little 15 terawatt hour of wind electricity, electricity production.
Okay.
So, quiz morning. There was no Chappie yesterday. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Just tell me if there was a Chappie and we'll make some more breaks.
There was a Chappie.
There was a Chappie. I want water. Okay, so do you have any idea about the total installed capacity of nuclear, gas, and renewable for electricity? So before that, we had figures in terms of energy, in terms of energy production, terawatt, it is energy, and here it is power. Do you have any idea about the total installed capacity for nuclear in Belgium?
I think
5 gigawatts, something like that. And in fact, it's easy to count because we have only two nuclear power plants in Belgium. We have Tihange, I don't know to say it in English, sorry. It can be Tihange, I don't know. So Tihange, let's say Tihange and Doel. And Tihange, we have three nuclear reactors, or I think it is 1,300 megawatts, something like that, but I'm not sure. And in Doel, we have four nuclear reactors. So in total in Belgium, we have 7 nuclear reactors. So we see, but it's almost that, almost 5 gigawatts. It's like 6 or 7, something like that. And for gas plants, any idea? Sorry? 30 gigawatts, okay. And for all the renewable electricity production, so wind and solar, do you have any idea? Remember, so.
So it's a peak. A peak renewable.
No, installed capacity.
Okay.
Installed capacity, it means what we have installed in terms of a wind farm, PV, all the total installed capacity in terms of power.
I'd say 5 gigawatts.
5 gigawatts. Okay. Maybe it's a little bit more because, for instance, remember, for last year, we have in total almost 25 terawatt hour of energy produced in 1 year. Do you know the capacity factors for solar and wind? 10% for wind and for solar? And wind? Maybe something like 20%. So you can do a quick calculation, in fact, and you can come back to the gigawatts. And so it is a little bit more than 5 gigawatts. So this is a nuclear, so it is like maybe 6 or 7, I cannot remember precisely, so 6 or 7 gigawatts. Then we have wind farm, you can see almost maybe 10 gigawatts. Here we have PV, maybe 5 gigawatts. Oh, sorry, wind is here, sorry, 5 or 6. PV is here, sorry, so maybe almost 7 or 8, and here it is gas. Gas is like 15. Gigawatt. But so you can see that we have more gigawatt of renewable installed capacity than nuclear, but we produce much less energy at the end, of course, because the capacity factor is between 10 and 20%, and for nuclear energy, it should be 80% if everything goes well. And you can see that we have installed more and more capacity over the last decades for wind and PV. But the gas capacity has not decreased, and it should not be the case for the next decade because, as you already know, Belgium plans to shut down the nuclear reactor, and it should, all the 7 nuclear reactors should be closed in 2025, sorry. And so probably we will build more gas plants. What do you want to say?
Almost in
2022. 2022, so in 3 years, 4 years. So we have to replace 7 gigawatts of installed capacity by something else, basically. But 7 gigawatts that produce 80% of the time. So 50% of the all the electricity. Yes?
How much time
will it take to replace that? Good question. It's quite quickly, in fact. But it takes a few years, like maybe 2 or 3 years max. But it's quite good. So, but it means that if we need to build 7 or 10 gigawatts of a gas plant, still we should not do that in 2025, just like, oh yes, now we have to build gas plant. But it will cost a lot of money. Okay. So remember, in Belgium, we use approximately 70% of fossil energy for all the energy that we use. Gas and oil, mainly a little bit of coal. Do you have any idea about the Belgian energy dependency? So I will try to define energy dependency to help you. The energy dependency means for a country, you consume an amount of energy, so X gigawatt or terawatt of energy. And you need to import sometimes a part of this energy. Do you have any idea about the Belgian dependency energy? So, and we use 70% of fossil energy, and I think you know that we have almost no fossil energy in Belgium. So probably the energy dependency should be a little bit high, because we depend on many countries to import oil and gas. So do you have any idea about now the energy dependency in terms of percentage? Do we import 5% of the energy, 10%, 50%?
80%?
Yes, something like that, because we use 70% of fossil energy. So Belgium is heavily dependent on other countries. But it is the same thing for France or Germany. It's not specifically the case of Belgium. And what are the types of energy imported?
Oil, gas.
Yes, oil and gas. Sorry?
Yeah. We also import nuclear.
Yes, yeah, so but uranium. It's a little bit different, but yes, we import uranium. So in fact, almost all the energy that we use. And except for renewable energy that we have here, but sometimes we import also the components to build wind farm or PV plants. So if we have a look at the net importation, so of course, oil, we import everything. Okay, no surprise. Same thing for gas, same thing for coal. And when we have a look at, for electricity, it's a little bit different. They do not count nuclear and that, but I agree with you, we import uranium. So in my opinion, it should be also included, but when they do the math, it is not included. It is a terms of definition. And we import, so over a year, we import a little bit of electricity. But the Belgian energy dependency is 78%, so 80%. 80% of energy that we need. And here we can have a look at the evolution over the last decade. So here it is the oil, gas, and can you remember, maybe it is coal. And so it fluctuates a little bit, but it is almost constant because we have not decreased the consumption of oil and gas over the last decade. So we import always the same amount of energy. Yeah, okay, so do you have any idea about where does come from the oil that we import in Belgium? Does it come from France or Germany?
The Middle East.
Yes, Middle East probably. So yeah, also because they have a lot of oil. So probably Middle East.
USA
maybe, okay. Norway, yes, maybe also. Venezuela. So OPEP, it's Middle East. But you have also Russia. So of course, Norway, it is true. So Middle East, but Russia. 30% of the oil we import comes from Russia. Russia is a big producer, but also of gas. You have the United States also, United Kingdom, and then it is over. But you can see that Middle East and Russia is more, it's almost 60% of all the oil we import from here in Belgium. So we are very dependent on Russia and Middle East. But Norway, it's true. They have produced a lot of oil, but now the oil production is decreasing. And what about the natural gas? Probably the same, no?
Russia.
Norway, Russia. Yeah. USA, maybe. So for gas, the main producer for Belgium is Norway. Then we have Netherlands, Qatar, and Russia. But you can see that the main are Norway and Netherlands. But in fact, the Netherlands, they import the gas. It's sorry?
And but they want to stop the Netherlands to use the gas.
But when? Like now, today? I do not know. That. Really? They plan to stop?
They plan to stop because they have a lot of time. Yeah, to an example,
due to gas.
Due to the
Okay, I didn't know that. Okay, now so we are getting close now to the topic of increase of gas and electricity increase in terms of price. So now if we have a look at the price of residential gas, so it is the gas that we buy as a residential consumer, in terms of cents of euro per kilowatt, you have any idea how much we pay as residential consumer? Maybe
25 cents.
Yeah, okay, maybe.
In fact, it's a little bit less.
If you take all the taxes, it's around between five and seven cents per kilowatt. Here are the some taxes. And in fact, here in that, you have the cost of energy, so the gas, but you have also the cost for transportation and distribution. So in fact, the real cost, just the gas, maybe it's 1 or 2 cents. And the same thing, but for electricity.
20 cents.
Yes. Maybe when you were saying 20, it was for electricity in your mind. Yes. Because yes, electricity is more expensive than gas.
And in fact, it is even more. So 10 years ago, it was around 20, 22.
And last year, it was over maybe 26 or 27 cents euro per kilowatt. And so here you have some tax. So here are some tax. Here you have the cost of only the electricity in terms of energy, and here you have the fee for transportation and distribution of the grid. But so in reality, the cost of electricity in terms of energy, it's around 5 or 6, 7 cents per kilowatt.
Okay.
So now it's not the same kind of price. Yes?
I know the price of gas will increase if I have to increase by why it
will have to. That's a good question, because this is what we are focusing now. And so this is a question here. So just before I was asking you the residential gas and electricity price. It is not the same price that you have in the energy market. So this is why I will provide you this lesson. It is to explain you how you can build an energy offer to a residential consumer by buying energy on the energy market and then selling this energy to the consumer. But it's not the same price, because in the energy market, it fluctuates a lot. And you, as a residential, and me, when we pay our bill, we do not have an electricity that every month is, goes up and goes and whatever. Most of the time, it is a fixed price. But we'll see that just up. That's the good question. So any idea of the calendar gas price on the energy market? What is a calendar? What is a calendar price? Do you have any idea about that? No? It's fine if you don't know.
It's a price for the whole next year?
Yes, it's a price for the whole next year. So it's a future price. So it's a price that you can buy electricity or gas on the energy market. And when you can buy this energy, you can buy different products, and you can buy gas for an entire year. So you say, oh, you want to buy this quantity of gas for the entire year, and you have a fixed price, and it is a calendar price, and it is the price for the next year. So here, it means what is the calendar price for the next year? So next year, gas, you have any idea in terms of euro per megawatt?
70,
probably.
So let's have a look at the figure. Maybe it will not be so easy to see, but so it starts in 2017 and it ends, so next year, 2022. And so you have different calendar price. You have the calendar price for next year. You have the calendar price for the year after, in 2023, and the calendar price for in 3 years. 3 years. And the calendar price of this year, which was 1 year before. And you can see that it fluctuates, but around 20 euro per megawatt hour, but okay, it's not so much. Here you have the COVID crisis. It decreased a little bit the price. And then here something starts happening at the beginning of this year. And it is referring to a question. You can see that something is happening. And so you can see that now it reached. So now it is more. It was 2 or 3 weeks ago, but it is around 70 euro per megawatt right now. So it means what? It means that the markets think that we will have something, maybe a problem with gas next year because the price is increasing. Something is happening. So it is true that over the last few weeks, the gas price has increased a lot. And we'll see that into more detail. But you can see that the calendar price for the year after, so in 2023 and 2024, is smaller than this one. So it means that the market thinks that still it will come back, not to normal, but it will be okay in 1 or 2 years. So the market does not think that it will last forever. But the markets can be wrong. So the question that is related to your question now, so I return the question. Why do you think the gas price is soaring, is increasing? Do you have any idea about it?
Okay.
Yeah, so problems of gas transportations.
With
Norway?
Norway, yes. Also. And Russia.
Yes, it is true. So it is one of the key factors. But there are other key factors, but good point. And as you have seen, we import a lot of gas, and it comes from Norway, Netherlands, and Russia. So, of course, if we have some problem to import this gas, it will be difficult. So the gas, the price is increasing. So any other idea about other key factors? Yes?
Due to the COVID crisis, there was a lot of industry that canceled out, and then they start again.
Mm-hmm.
So because of the fact that they need to produce furniture, they need energy, mm-hmm. and they all need energy at the same time.
Yes.
And moreover, we are like in winter, and in winter we want to make some reserve.
Yes, I don't know how to call it. Reserve.
Store.
You need to store gas.
So all of this makes the price.
So the first part we have difficulties to import gas. On the other part, we have the demand that is increasing because after the COVID crisis, everybody starts to consume a lot, to produce a lot of things. So it means that we need more gas at the same time. Okay, it's true. And we need to store gas before the winter. But at the same time, we need a lot of gas for the winter months. Okay. So we will see one by one, in fact. But here you have all the main drivers that explain why the gas price is increasing. First, the demand. The gas demand is increasing here in Belgium. We need more gas. So we need to consume more gas due to winter and the post-COVID crisis. On the other way, we have the offer that is decreasing, less import of gas, for instance, from Russia and from Norway. So we want to consume more, but we have less gas. Of course, the price is increasing. So we'll see just one by one. So one of the first thing is the increase of the China gas consumption. And here you can see the gas consumption spread over the year by month. And you have the consumption last year, and so during the COVID crisis, but the year before. And here you have the consumption of this year, and you can see that the consumption of gas is higher than the previous year. So it means that right now China is consuming much more gas than the previous year. And if China is consuming more gas, it means that the price is going up in China. And so if the price is going up in China, the country that sells gas, they say, okay, I can make more profit in China because the price is higher in China than in Europe. So they export the gas in China. If they export the gas in China, we have less gas in Europe. Then, as you said, we need to store gas before the winter. Here it is. It is a level of storage in terms of filling rate over the last year. And here it is a storage filling rate of this year. And you can see that it is smaller than over the previous year. It means that we have some difficulties in storing gas before the winter. And so right now the storage, they should be maybe here, and we are here. So it's not good, yes?
Why is it seasonal?
Ah, good question. So what do we do in winter with the gas? Heating, yes, we heat house. So we store gas before the winter. The energy producer, they store gas and they have to. They have to. It's a legal obligation. In fact, they have to buy gas and to store it, because if the winter is very harsh, very cold, we need to have some gas. Otherwise, maybe we will have some economic problem. So that's why it's a legal obligation to secure gas import before the winter. So that's why the filling rate is increasing before the winter. And then it is, of course, decreasing. Here it is starting of the year on the 1st of January. And of course, it is decreasing during the winter because we consume the gas that is stored during the winter. Because we consume so much gas during the winter that the import cannot balance the demand. You need to have an additional sources of gas that is stored into your reserves. So you consume a part of the gas that you store during the winter, and then after the winter, you start to filling up your storage for the next winter. But this year, right now, the filling rate of the storage is smaller than previous year. So of course it adds something else on the energy market, because it says we want more gas to store the gas, but yes, we have no gas because it is in China. So the price is rising up. And in addition, probably you remember at the end of this winter, this year in March, April, March, the weather was quite cold, in fact, and it was not usual. So it means that in addition, we consume more gas than usual this year than previous year. So that's why the storage were quite low at this time. And so here we have the European gas consumption. Here it is during the COVID crisis, and here it is a range between 2015 and 2029. So during the COVID crisis, we consume a little bit less of gas than the average. And after the COVID crisis, we start to consume more. So we consume more gas after the COVID crisis. So the gas is in China. We have some problem to import gas from Netherlands, Norway, and Russia. We had a difficult winter. We have difficulties in storing gas, and we consume more gas. And all of these factors, they explain why the price is soaring. And there is an additional factor. Okay, so here it is the Russian gas export, to show you the Russian gas export. And so this year, you can see the export in comparison of the average. You can see that we are at the bottom of the average Russian export. So we have difficulties in importing gas from Russia for political reasons. So what will happen? Okay, so for this winter, we'll have a very high gas price. But what will happen in the medium term, so between 5 or 10 years? Probably it will come back almost to normal in 1 year or two, but the gas price will still be quite high. Why? Because the gas demand should remain consequent in the coming decade and even increase, because
we will need gas to make the energy transition. If we want to shut down coal plants and nuclear plants in Europe, so Germany has a lot of coal plants, for example, but also Poland and other many countries, they will replace a part of this coal plant by renewable plant, but also by gas plant. And so the demand of gas in Europe will still increase for the next decade. And the Russian exports are completely uncertain. They are not reliable. So 1 year, maybe you can import a lot of gas, and maybe the other way, for political reasons, they will not export a fairly amount of gas. And Europe is dependent on the Asia demand. If China keeps on consuming much more gas, probably the price of gas will remain low in China. So if the price of gas is high in China, they will export gas into China to make profit. So it means that it will drive up the price of gas here in Europe. So for the next decade, probably the price of gas will remain low. Of course, it is not it's not an oracle prediction. Maybe it will be something else. Maybe we'll have another COVID. I don't know. You know what I mean. But this is the expectation right now. Yes.
All the things that gas plants
When I say come back to normal, it's not normal like 10 years ago. It will never come back to 10 years ago where the price was at 20 euros per megawatt. When I mean normal, it's like not 70 or 100 of euros per megawatt. It's like we will not have, the price right now is very, very high. So it will go to a peak and then it will come back to not normal, but when I mean normal, it's like not a peak of 100 or 150 euros per megawatt, but it will remain high, but not 100 euros per megawatt. And why is that? It is because it's a lot of factors that are happening now. And next year it will be different. We assume that we will not have another COVID crisis. We hope so. So the demand should remain now. So demand is high, but the demand should be almost the same, a little bit increasing. We'll have probably more imports from Norway and Russia. Russia will open a new line for gas, North Gas Stream 2. It will be effective next summer. So it should be able to export more gas to Europe and so on. So that's why the market thinks that it will come back to normal. But still, we've a fairly high level. And then on the long term for Europe, so in 30 years, so in 2050, I think you already know that in 2015, we have the Green Deal in Europe. And what is the Green Deal? The Green Deal is neutral carbon. We need to achieve, we need to be neutral carbon in 30 years. So neutral carbon means that we consume much less of fossil energy, so gas, coal, and oil. So if you consume much less of this energy, there is no problem with the price. So if everything happens as it is planned, Europe should phase out from fossil energy. So the gas demand should decrease and the price will not be a problem.
This one is to show you why that the market anticipates a decrease in the gas price starting next summer. Here it is not the calendar price, it is a quarter price. So you have different kinds of products on the energy market. You can buy electricity for 1 year, but you can buy also electricity or gas for a quarter, but also a month, also a week, also a day. And here it is a quarter price. And so you can see that the price for quarters next year, they are smaller than the price for quarter of next year. So it means that the market still thinks that even if the price is higher than before, we can see the difference between both prices. But the market is not always right. Okay, I think I will skip this one because, yes. You have the slide anyway, because it is the same thing for the day ahead gas price. Do you know the difference between future market and day ahead market? If you are in an energy market, I think you already saw that, no?
Yes. Can you explain me the day ahead market?
What is the day ahead market?
okay. Sorry. The calculation of the price is very different. We have a pool with demand and offers, and the algorithm that calculates the price, so it's very different of the calendar price, which is defined long time before
the demand. And the day-ahead market, it happened just one day before the delivery, which is every day, and it is electricity or gas for the day after only. And so it fluctuates a lot by definition. But the trend is the same for the day-ahead market as for the calendar price. It means that right now, the gas price on the day-ahead market is very, very high, even higher than the calendar price, and because it fluctuates a lot. But I will not go into detail because it is the same explanation than for the calendar price. It is the same factors that are explaining why the day-ahead gas price is increasing right now. It is the same thing. But just it is the price is higher because of the day-ahead market is fluctuating.
So I will skip the slide about this. You can have it at home. But you can see that the day-ahead price here is higher than the calendar price. And right now, it's even much more higher. So you have everything here. OK. What about the calendar electricity price?
We are focused a lot on gas price. What do you think about the electricity price?
It will increase a bit less, but it will still increase because electricity is a lot of production comes from gas. So if the gas is more expensive, the electricity is more expensive too.
Yes, yes. So yes, there is a direct link, in fact, because we produce a lot of electricity in Belgium and in Europe by using gas. So if the gas price is higher, the electricity price is higher. So, but in fact, it goes even. In fact, it's much more, it's a little bit more difficult than that, because if you know it, how the price, the electricity price is clear on the day-ahead market. So you have an algorithm, the FEMIA, that will compute the price. And in fact, the price that is clear is the price of the last kilowatt hour needed to meet the demand. It is like that. It is a marginal price of the production. And most of the time, it is a gas plant that is used to meet the last kilowatt hour, because nuclear is more like the base of production. Mean the renewable, they produce when we have renewables. So it is just like that. We use them. And then at the end, we meet the demand by using the gas power plant to balance the demand. And most of the time, it is a gas plant. So it means that if the gas price is increasing, it means that the electricity price will always increase, because most of the time the last kilowatt hour is produced by the gas.
So of course the calendar electricity price is increasing. And so you can see the same trend than for the gas. The electricity price for the next year has increased. And for the year after, the market will come back to normal. So the same key factor. So the main key factors are, of course, the gas. Here you have the gas calendar price, and here you have the electricity calendar price. So you can see the gas price is increasing. So it is the main factor. We have also the coal price that is also increasing, and the coal is also used to produce electricity. And you have another key factor that is a CO2 price. So you have a market for exchanging CO2 at the European level. So the ETS market, have you already heard of that? No? So to meet a legal obligation of decreasing greenhouse gas emission in Europe, Europe has launched a carbon market where when you are an industry, you emit greenhouse gas, you have to buy some quota of carbon to meet that emission. And so you have a market where you can exchange this quota, because sometimes we produce less emission than expected. So you can sell your quota to someone else that, in fact, produce more emission than expected. And so you have to meet your emission with quota. And the Europe set every year a quota of emission. And you cannot produce more emission than this quota. And so there is a price
for this carbon. Over the last decade, the price was quite low. It was like 10 euro per ton of CO2 emission. But right now it is 60 euro per ton. Because Europe last summer has decreased the level of quota and has taken some directions to make the price of the ton of CO2 increasing to oblige companies and industry to decrease the emission. And it happens at the same time that all the other factors, so it was not, it is unexpected, but so it means that the ton of CO2, the price is increasing, but gas, the gas on the coal, when you burn them, they emit CO2. So it means that you need to buy, it means that you need to buy quota that are much more expensive. So it drives up the price of coal and gas even more higher. So it means that the price of electricity is rising. So you have the price of coal, the price of gas, and the price of CO2 emission. And here it is a correlation. Here you have the electricity calendar price. Here it is a coal price, and here it is a gas price and the CO2 emission, ton of CO2 emission price. And you can see that when the electricity price is rising up, it is correlated to the coal, gas, and CO2. It is directly related. Okay. So it is a summary of what I just said. We have a merit of order effect, the current price is related to the cost of the last kilowatt hour produced. And most of the time, it is a coal or gas power plant. So as the gas price is rising up, the electricity price is rising up. And you have also the increase of the price of CO2, ton of CO2 emission. Okay. It is the same thing for the day ahead prices. So I skip it. You can have it on the slide. Okay. So now let's come back to the energy offer. Are we concerned or not? Because we are residential consumers, so we buy electricity and gas. So right now, are we concerned? Do you think that we are concerned by this increase?
Yes.
Yes. Are you sure about that? It means that right now, if I take my monthly electricity or gas bill, is it increasing?
Yes.
Yes?
Depends.
No? Depends? Yeah. Sorry?
It depends on the retailer. Some retailers can already have imposed an increase.
Uh-huh.
But in the end, we have to pay for it next year.
No, so yes, for sure, probably next year, we are all concerned. But right now, in fact, the answer is it depends. And why it depends? First, it depends on the type of contract that you have with your energy retailer. You can have a fixed price contract or a variable price contract. So if you have a fixed price with your energy retailer, it's okay if you negotiate your contract before that, before this crisis, because the price is fixed for 1 year. So they cannot increase the price. But if it is a variable price, of course, right now, your price is fluctuating on your bills. And in Belgium, in fact, 68% of consumers have a fixed price contract for electricity and 64% for gas. So the majority of people, they have fixed contracts. So right now, they should not be concerned by this increase, but probably next year, as it is a 1 year contract, when you will have the contract will end, then we'll renew a contract, but with a much more higher price. So if I were you, I will just have a look at my electricity bill to see what kind of contract I have, fixed or variable. If it is fixed, just do nothing. And have a look at when your contract ends. If it ends after the next winter, I think it's good for you. But if it ends, for instance, in 1 month, so just before the winter, be careful because your energy retailer will probably propose you another fixed contract, but with a price that is very, very high. So the answer depends. Oh, do you know the main energy market player? producer, yes. Energy producer, yes. Okay, so energy producer.
Yes.
DSO. Consumers, yes. Consumer, they are key, yes.
Retailer,
energy retailer. So energy producer, consumer, DSO, retailer. Okay. TSO, yes. TSO, yes.
Good.
So the energy producer, they produce energy, gas or electricity. This electricity or gas goes through a grid. So it depends if it is gas or electricity, but it is a grid, you have a grid. And the TSO, it is for the transportation system, and the DSO, it is for distribution system. And they will provide energy to the residential customer, industrial consumer. Most of the time, the industrial customer, they are large consumer, like Solvay, for instance, in Belgium. And you have here the energy supplier that are kind of middleman between the producer and the consumer. Because of course, us as a residential consumer, we do not call the nuclear power plant of Flush to say, okay, just send me your energy, please. We do not do that. It's impossible. So you have an energy retailer that does the job for you. You have also the energy market. Because the energy supplier, where do they buy the energy? On the energy market. And you have also the regulator. It's a kind of policy of energy that sets some rules. And here on this presentation, we focus on the energy supplier. The video is in French. I will not show you, but I encourage you to watch the video that lasts 3 minutes and that explains the key main market player. And I think you can set a subtitle in English as it is in YouTube for the ones who do not speak French. So the goals of presentation is explain you why does an energy supplier, how does an energy supplier build a residential electricity or gas offer, what is a green energy offer, and how to compare energy supplier, but very quickly. Do you have any idea about the main missions of an energy supplier? Yeah, there is one that is obvious. Sorry?
Supply energy.
Yeah, supply energy, obviously. It's like a football player. What does a football player do? That's football. So yes, supply energy. Do you know if they do something else? Any idea or not? No? No idea? They are the middleman between the consumer and the transmission system operator. And here it is not related to buying energy, in fact. It means that they have to balance their energy perimeter. It is a legal obligation. When you are an energy supplier, you have an energy portfolio. It is composed of a residential consumer, but it can be also composed of industrial customers. So you have a lot of customers, and you have to supply them energy because you have a contract with them. And the TSO oblige you to balance this perimeter. It means that you have to supply at every time the exact amount of energy that your consumer needs to. It's a legal obligation. And so the energy supplier, they are called balancing responsible party. Balancing responsible party, because they have to balance the demand and the energy supply of all their customers. And if they do not do that, they have to pay some fines, just like that. And so this is a TSO that is the main guy, and to say to all energy suppliers, you have to do that, And if you do not do that, I will make you pay some fines. So they are balancing responsible party. They buy or sell energy, but they do also the customer care. If you have a problem with an energy bill, you do not call Elia, the TSO. You do not call Tian, hey man, I do not have electricity. What did you do with your nuclear power plant? You do not do that. You buy your energy supplier. So they do the customer care. Then sometimes they'll provide also additional services, for instance, insurance, grid installation, and so on. So an energy supplier, in fact, they have a lot of mission, and they of course they supply energy, but it is just one of their mission. Here on this link, you can have a look at what is your DSO, because in Belgium you have a lot of DSO. And the DSO is different, for instance, in Liège or in Bruxelles or in Anvers and so on. You know what is a DSO, in fact, because I just use that, but have you already seen that in the previous lesson? Yes. Okay. So now let's build the residential energy offer. So here you have the producer that produces energy. It goes to the transmission system and then to the distribution system and up to the consumers, large or small. But you have also financial fluxes, because as a consumer, we buy energy to the supplier. So we give money to the energy supplier. The energy supplier buy energy on the market. So the money goes there. And the money goes to the producer. And so the price of the energy on the energy market, it fluctuates a lot. But at the end, the energy supplier can provide us a fixed contract. So it means the price is fixed. And sometimes it is a variable price. But how is it possible that an energy supplier can sell us energy at a fixed price if the price on the energy market is never fixed? It's a little bit strange, no? I don't know for you, but for me, it looks a little bit strange. The price is not fixed on the energy market. It's always fluctuating. So how is it possible that an energy supplier can do that? This is what we will see. Yes?
Like,
people really
like the for the gas, anticipate the price for 1 year, and the price for the
year. Yeah, but you do not consume the same amount of gas every day of the year. So how do you do you determine the price?
We consume the average the same amount of money.
Yes, on average, but the price is fluctuating all the year. So on the market, for instance, the price of gas is higher in the winter than during the summer. And you consume more gas during the winter than during the summer. So how can you fix the price? Because you will buy energy not one time on the market, but a lot of time. So how at the end you sell a contract that has a fixed price? How are you sure that you will have the right price for this gas? Better.
More or less.
More or less. Yeah, but if you make a mistake, maybe of 5%, finish. Sold out. So no energy retailer.
Well, you have to do risk management.
Yes, risk management. So there are some techniques to do that, and we'll see how to do that. This is the purpose of the course, in fact. But it's not so easy to say, okay, probably this price. And as you can see right now, how the price is increasing, almost nobody expected that 5 months ago. So imagine the energy retailer right now, how they are like. So I hope they have really good risk asset management. So first, what are the components of the electricity bill? Here it is Wallonia, and here it is in Brussels, and I don't know how to say it in English, Flanders? Yes. In Flanders, it is approximately the same. So in Wallonia, when you take your electricity bill, the energy part is around 40%, and Brussels 45%. You have some tax here, and here you have the transportation and distribution cost. But the energy part of all your electricity bill or gas bill, it is around 30% and 40%. And it is the same for gas, it's a little bit more, like it's like 60%. But it is right now, so it is it's unexpected. Most of the time, it's a little bit less because the energy, the cost of gas is a little bit smaller. But you can, it's around 50% or something like that. It's like when you buy oil for your car, in fact. You have a lot of taxes, and the cost of energy is much more smaller than the total amount. In Belgium, we have access to a lot of energy supplier, and for electricity and gas, and on average, we have 20 different energy supplier for gas and electricity. So you have a lot of choice when you are a consumer to select the one that you want. And the most famous are of course Lampyris, Engie, and Luminous. But you have in fact 20 energy suppliers.
A lot of choices. Yeah, no. Here on this link, if you click on it, you will see the Walloon fuel mix. And so you will have a list of all energy suppliers, and you will see how much energy they supply.
And you will see that Luminous, Engie, and Lampyris, they are the main energy supplier, but you can see a lot of other energy supplier and with the amount of energy they supply.
But I will not show you that, just for information. So I just answer that question, it is Engie. So if we have a look at the Wallonia, so Electrabel, it is Engie. They supply 45% of the electricity, and for gas, 35%. And then you have Luminous for electricity and gas, then Lampyris, and you have also some other energy supplier like Eneco and so on.
Do you know what is a guarantee of origin? Have you ever heard of that before? Probably not, I'm not sure. But you have already heard about green offer, probably. It's green. A lot of energy suppliers say, okay, come to me, it is green. It's like for the car, you know. But they say, okay, if you buy electricity from me, it will be green. Okay, so but what is a green energy offering? So this is why you have to define the concept of guarantee of origin. There is a nice video about that, and I will not show you, but you can click on the link. That will explain you in 3, 4, 5 minutes what is a guarantee of origin. And it is performed by the Réveilleur. Do you know the Réveilleur? It is quite serious. It is a French YouTuber, but I think his girlfriend is Belgian. And you can click on the link, and you will see that how the mechanism is. And you can, I think, set the subtitle in English. It should work. But otherwise, the guarantee of origin is just a tracking instrument defined by a European directive. And if you are an electricity producer, but for instance, you have a wind farm or a PV farm, when you produce electricity from this farm, you can have a guarantee of origin. So it's like a paper that says for this quantity of energy, it has been produced by a wind farm from that time to that time. And so it's like an identity card of the wind farm, of the PV farm. And then you can, if you want, sell that guarantee of origin, or when you sell your electricity to the energy supplier, you sell the energy, but you can also sell the guarantee of origin. And so like that, the energy supplier, when buys the electricity, buys also a guarantee of origin. And then when it sells the energy to us, to the customers, we can be sure that this electricity has been produced by a wind farm or a solar farm, because we can have access to the guarantee of origin. And so it's really a tracking device. And so if an energy supplier offer you a green offer, then if you ask them to see the guarantee of origin, they have to show this guarantee of origin. And they cannot sell you energy that is said to be green if they did not purchase the guarantee of origin to the producer. It is a law. It's like that. So this is what defines a green energy offer. It is energy with a guarantee of origin. If you do not have the guarantee of origin, you cannot say it is green. So you can be an energy supplier, you can buy electricity to wind farm, but if you do not purchase the guarantee on origin, it is not good. So this is how it works. And so of course, if you are a gas power plant or a coal power plant, you cannot have access to guarantee of origin. And it is the same thing for nuclear. You cannot have access to guarantee of origin. So it is not related to CO2 emission. Be careful about that. When we say that an energy offer is green, it is not, it has nothing to do with the CO2 emission. There is a list of energy sources that can have access to a guarantee of origin. And it, they are renewable energy like wind, solar, and biomass, hydraulic. Nuclear, even if it has low CO2 emission, they do not have access to guarantee of energy. And this is how we can make green and non-green offer. And if we have a look at the origin of this guarantee, most of the time in Wallonia, they come from hydraulic. And then you have biomass, wind, and solar. But it looks a little bit strange because, in fact, we do not have a lot of hydraulic production in Wallonia or even in Belgium. So there is something strange here. So if that's a question. All the geos do come from Belgium. Do you think that or not?
No.
In fact, only 30% of the guarantee of origin, they come from Belgium. And it can come from every country in Europe. And in fact, you know that electricity, they are these electrons that goes through the grid. So you cannot say this electron, it goes from that power plant to my house. It is not like that. So when an energy supplier builds an energy offer, it can buy energy on the energy market. So it can buy, for instance, wind electricity from a producer here in Wallonia. And it can buy the guarantee of origin of that producer. But it can also buy energy from another country. On the energy market, you have access to energy of, from all over the country because in Europe we are connected. So you can buy energy from hydraulic energy in Norway. And so you can buy the guarantee of origin too. For them. And then you can do also something completely different. You can buy energy in one place and you can buy the guarantee of energy in another place. And you can mix it. And then it becomes green. So you can buy energy from a wind farm in France. And you can buy the guarantee of origin of a hydraulic power plant in Norway. And then you sell the energy to the customer, it is green because you have a guarantee of origin in Norway and you have energy from the wind farm. So that's why, in fact, it's completely, it's not correlated. You do not have to buy the guarantee of origin related to the power plant where you buy energy. That's why most of the guarantee of origin do not come from Belgium. So how to make a green offer by purchasing energy on the energy market? One way is, so as an energy supplier, you buy energy on the energy market. But on this energy market, you do not know where comes from the energy. So maybe it comes from a gas power plant, maybe from a nuclear power plant, maybe from a wind farm. You do not know anything about that because you just purchase energy on the energy market. So you say, I want 10 gigawatt of energy. And someone say, okay, no problem, we provide you 10 gigawatt of energy. And then you go to another market, on the geo market, guarantee of energy market, and someone will sell you guarantee of origin. And with this guarantee of origin, you can say, it's okay, my energy offer is green. Even if you don't know where you come from the energy. But this guarantee of origin, they have a price.
Can I ask?
Yes, sure.
What provides the guarantee origin for the customer? I mean, if for any customers, what is the difference between the, if you get your energy, GO market, energy markets, because you are a customer and you need just energy?
In terms of energy, nothing. There is no difference.
Yeah.
There is no difference, I think.
But for the all the purpose of the green work, maybe that's why government
it's a way, in fact, to help renewable production, because if you purchase a green offer, you pay a part of your electricity bill will go for the guarantee of origin, and this is another it's a little bit of money for the energy producer, for wind farm. But it is the same electricity. There is no difference between electricity from a gas plant, from a nuclear power plant, for a wind farm.
And also, it don't have to be all obligatory, so right, to buy markets. For the green deals, to get the for the green deals, it's don't have to be obligatory for to buy beer for consumers.
As consumers, we buy what we want.
Yeah.
You do not have to buy a green energy offer. You buy what you want.
But we have the one big goal to, you know, achieve green deal.
The Green Deal is something at the European level. The Green Deal is like a lot of directions to help to decrease the greenhouse gas emission.
Yeah.
It's something else. The Green Deal is a European level. And in that Green Deal, there are some directions, and they design this guarantee of origin because they say, okay, maybe if the customers pay for guarantee of origin, it will bring more money to the renewable energy producer, so it will help them to be more competitive with the fossil energy, because the fossil energy, well, they will not have guarantee of origin. So they will have less money than the other one. It is the main idea behind that.
Yeah, but the government doesn't have to consumer for it.
No, it's a customer that have to pay. Yeah. It's because they decided to do that like that. They could have done it differently, but it is the way the market is working. But in fact, it's not fairly true, because into the tax that we pay for electricity, a part of this tax, they go to help investment in renewable energy. But it is the tax that we pay also. So. But at the end, it is always the same. It is what we pay that will be used to do something else. Okay. Is it okay for you, that part? Because it's not so easy to understand. So if an energy supplier offer you a green energy offer, it means that they have to purchase a guarantee of origin, and you can ask them, okay, it's okay, but can you give me your guarantee of origin? I want to see them. And they have to make it public. But so as you understand, in terms of energy, you can go on the energy market, you can buy a mix of energy between a gas power plant, a coal power plant, a nuclear power plant, a wind farm, a PV farm. At the end, you have an amount of energy and you just purchase the related amount of guarantee of origin that it will give you. Or you can say, okay, I just want to buy energy from a wind farm, and you buy also the guarantee of origin, and it is also wind. But all of these offers, they are completely the same. At the end, they are good. It is a guarantee of origin that defines them as green. It is not the energy, where does it come from? Yes? No, it depends. It is completely up to the energy retailer to define the price that will pay the customers. But most of the time, the green energy offer, they are a little bit more expensive than non-green because you have to pay for the guarantee of origin. And there is another way of doing that to build an energy offer is to bypass the energy market. An energy retailer can bypass the energy market and go directly to a producer and say, I want to buy your energy. Directly. They buy the energy to wind farm, they set the price, and they sell the energy to a customer. Because it's not an obligation for the energy retailer to buy energy on the energy market. The energy market is easier because you have access to a lot of producers and everything is mixed, so you have a price and so on. But you can, if you want, go directly to a producer and try to make a contract with them.
And it's more expensive.
It depends. It depends the price that you have in your contract with the energy producer. Because for the energy producer, it may be interesting to do that, because if the energy producer sells its energy to the market, there will be a price to remunerate the market too. So maybe if it sells the energy directly to the energy supplier, as it bypasses the energy market, they can maybe sell the energy a little bit more, with the price a little bit more higher. And for the energy supplier, it is still okay because it does not have to pay free access to the market. In fact, it's exactly the same as for food. If you buy your food directly to a big shop like Carrefour or so on, or if you go directly to the farm,
It depends on the price, but sometimes when you go directly to the farm, you have access to the same same food or same products, but for a cheaper price. So it is the same idea, but for energy. And there is a video from the Réveilleur that explains that. So you have also the link if you want to watch it. You can watch it. It's five minutes, something like that. Okay, a little bit small recap. And then after that, we will have a break. Watch, 2 minutes. So how an energy supplier builds a residential electricity offer? It can directly buy the energy to the producer, and so it bypasses the energy market. And so, for instance, my energy supplier could go directly to wind farm and set a contract with that wind farm, and it's okay. And with that way, it means that you can assume that your money will go directly into the pocket of the producer and the energy retailer, of course, because you do not have to pay something for the market. Or you can make a market-based offer. So it means that as an energy retailer, you go, you purchase your energy on the energy market, but it means that probably the money will go to many more market players. Or you can make a mix. You can buy a part of your energy directly to a producer and another part of the energy on the energy market. Because when you buy your energy directly to the producer, maybe you will not have enough energy to supply all of your customers.
Or you can produce
your energy. Yeah, some energy retailers are also producers. But this is what you mean, or?
No.
As customer?
Yeah.
Ah, yeah, okay. It's something else because, yes, for instance, as customer, you can have PV panel on your house, for instance, and you can produce a part of your energy. But it's completely different than that because you do not need an energy supplier to do that. But probably that you will not produce as much as energy as you need. So probably you will need a contract with an energy supplier to balance sometimes your consumption, because it's very difficult to be to have a self consumption during the entire year. Sometimes we produce more than we consume, and sometimes it will be the opposite. And so, what is a green energy offer? The answer is that you need the guarantee of origin to define a green energy, and you only need that. Sorry. It does not have anything to do with the origin of the energy. And it does not have anything to do with the CO2 emission level of the energy. There is a list of kind of energy, wind, hydraulic, PV, that can have access to a guarantee of origin. So green does not mean low carbon footprint. It should help, but it does not mean low carbon footprint for electricity. Because as you know, the carbon footprint of electricity for wind, PV, is not the same. And it is not zero, even if it is smaller than coal, of course. Okay. Okay. If you want to dig the topic on green electricity offer, you can watch the entire video from the Réveilleur. He has also a blog about it, and there are also some publication from Carbon 4, but I think this one is in French and this one French. And the video also is in French, but maybe you can set the subtitle in English. Okay. So as a conclusion, it's almost impossible to compare energy supplier just only a guarantee of origin, because there is a whole market of guarantee of origin and they purchase guarantee of origin everywhere in Europe. So it's very difficult to say, okay, this one is better than this one. And so maybe some possible criteria to compare them are just to have a look at the energy mix. And so you have access to the energy mix. So for instance, to see if a particular energy supplier buy more nuclear energy or more coal and so on. And so depending on what you want, maybe you want an energy supplier that do not buy nuclear energy or that do not buy coal, I don't know. You can have access to the carbon footprint of this energy mix. You can also, maybe some energy supplier have more transparent way in terms of financial fluxes, because they, for instance, energy supplier, they buy directly energy to the producer. It's easier to know where goes your money, in fact, that if your money goes to the market. Maybe you would like to prefer an energy supplier that buy a Belgian guarantee of origin, or maybe Norway guarantee of origin, I don't know. Maybe you would like an energy supplier that will make a direct contract with the producer. Maybe you would prefer a market-based offer, so then it depends. So, but then these are some criteria on which you can make a choice to select your energy producer. But just remind that green does not mean low carbon footprint, even if it helps, but it does not mean low carbon footprint. Okay. Do you have any question right now? And we make a short break. If no question, we make the break. And I propose you, is 15 minutes okay? Or you or only 10 minutes, depends on you. 10 or 15? 15? Go, 15.